What's up, guys? Welcome to my third QGIS tutorial. In the tutorial series, but we are going today. We are going to look at the vector and the raster data, and just to look about how we can visualize them and in QGIS, and also how to download some raster data. So we are going to look. We're going to start with the vector data. The vector data is data that consists of lines, polygons, and polygons and points. And the raster data is some form of continuous kind of data rather than discrete, and it is defined in pixels, and it's also like something like a bitmap. So its form of data structure is continuous. So we are going to download our vector data, and if you want to download the vector data, you can use the OSM, OpenStreetMap data repository, that is at geofabric.de, assuming the D is for Deutsch, German. So we have the GeoFabric. This is a homepage for GeoFabric. You can see there is a lot of it contains a lot of things. I'm going to share this link in the description, and we have tools and also downloads. So we are just going to go to the downloads page under service. So this is how this page looks like. It's at download.geofabric.de. We have a map on our on the right side. And we have a number of information on different items. So we have on our left, there's a table below whereby we have regions which are represented by the continents. And we also have the quick links whereby you can download your data in osm.pbf, which is a compressed format. For OSM data, you can also download the data in form of shapefile, which is indicated here by .shp, which is zipped shapefiles, and you can also download your data in form of zipped OSM, which is osm.bbz2, which is using the bzip format. So we are going to proceed to the download. So if you want to download, you can click on your continent, preferred continent. So in this case, I'll click on Africa. And under Africa, the table now has changed, and it has brought a list of items. So these are the countries that are within the continent of Africa. And on the left, if you see, you can see that it is highlighted, the continent is highlighted, or the coverage of the data is highlighted in the map on the right side. So I'm going to download, you can download the data, and this data is updated regularly. I'm assuming it's on a probably daily basis or within times within the day. So we have the sizes also, which have been indicated. So I'm going to download the data for Namibia. And yeah, I can choose to download whichever format that I want. So I'm just going to download this Namibia latest osm.pbf. And the download has started below here. So I've chosen Namibia because it has a small size. And also the speed of the download will depend on your internet. So after downloading it, I'm just going to do a drag and drop. To my folder. So this is where it is. So I'm just going to minimize my browser, and I'm going to open QGIS. So this is the data. As you can see, it is 37 or 38 megabytes. So this is a compressed format used by OSM. So I'm just going to do a drag and drop, and On dragging and dropping, it brings a list of the items or the list of datasets formats. So we have a line string, we have multi lines in the data. We also have multi polygon, sorry. We also have geometry collection and points. So, and the layer ID. So every layer usually has it's assigned an ID starting from zero, and the layer names as it's going to appear, and the number of features. So I'll just select all and I click OK, and I can also choose to add them into a group. So I'll just click OK. So as you can see, there are points that are loading, and on the layers panel, if you have you do not see your layers panel, you can as well come here and under the view menu and activate your layers panel on your QGIS. So it's populating, it's adding those data sets. So these are data that has been populated by the OSM contributors, and normally you can add these you can add your data by, you know, having the OSM application in your device, could be your phone, and then you can navigate while you're updating those points. That's why they seem to be so many, because there are so many contributors. So while it's populating, we can try and check it being vector data. We'll start with the points, and I'll select my Namibia latest points and open the attribute table. So as you can see, it is counting the number of it's counting the features. So as from my visual interpretation of the map or the in the canvas, it shows that the points are so many. They are the most features. As you can see, it's calculating. So just to save on time, let me just abort that, so that it can show me the attribute table for the data sets that it has loaded. So these are the points, and these are the points for the data for the points. So most of the data in between seems to be null, but it's probably because I've cut short the populating of all those points. So we have what we call the OSM ID, name, barrier. These represents the columns, the fields. So this is one way you can get your data and also visualize it. Let me check also the properties for the polygon, which is a Namibian polygon. Can open the attribute table. Yeah, so you can do your raster, your vector, sorry. You can do your vector visualization. You can check the polygons, the points data. You can modify it. You can also create your own map. So it's taking some time to show. Yeah. So this is a polygon. This seems to be a multi-polygon. Yeah, so this is the attribute data for the multi-polygons, and it's showing us the total number of features, which is 99, and also the filtered features and selected features. So once if I select a field here, you notice that it appears as selected, and if I click Control and my keyboard and continue clicking on the polygon, it indicates the number of selected features. So yeah, so that is what we have on the polygons. I can just close it. and then we can check on the lines. Yeah, so the data could be massive for other specific countries that have a lot of data. So it could take time to visualize and populate, or to populate the data on the map. Therefore, we should do that, knowing that some data could be very big or very large. Yeah, so it's showing the line features. So I've clicked on a bot so that it can indicate or show us some data. So we have this is the attribute table for the lines. As you can see, it's also telling us filtered, none of the features have been selected. So what we are going to do, we can also use what we call the field calculator, or the selecting features using an expression. So we have something that we call the QGIS expression. So I can see that we have this table, attribute table. It has a column called the highway, and it has some data. So I wanted to take advantage of this. So we have this highway, and it has unclassified and cycleway, footway, and truck, among others. So I can filter or select all the line features that whose highway is unclassified. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to select alright. So just to make it easier, you can come here and select fields and values. So I'll just double click highway and select the value classified. Then I close my, so it seems not to pick up. Okay, so we can try using null. So the data seems to be a bit unresponsive because it's massive. Gotta give it some time. Yeah, so it's showing us above here there's a notification in orange or amber saying that there are no features that have been selected. So let's values and check the Z order. Which the field seems to be having and using integer values. So you can see above the top here, the place where I have placed my cursor. Okay, so it seems to have put it two times. If I put 0, it seems to have an output preview of 1. So there's one feature that, as you can see below here, output preview shows us the output, the numbers or the number of items that are going to have that specific value. So if there's one value that has 0, so I can just select that feature. So it gives us the count of the features that have a given a value. So these QGIS expressions are it's one of the rich features of QGIS, whereby you can do a lot of things. So it's telling us that there are 79,000 matching records. So at the moment it's selecting those records, and here they are. They are being selected. So it might seem unresponsive because of the data. It's massive, and remember I did not allow it to populate all the attributes for all the data sets. So anyway, this is what you call the field calculator, or the QGIS expression, sorry. And then you also have the field calculator that more or less uses the same QGIS expression, but you can use it to create a new field or a new column if you wish, or you can also do an update to the fields. It's a more of less way of editing or creating. You can use it to do multiple data editing or multiple data values. So this is just how you can download and visualize the vector data. So for more of the vector analysis, we are going to look it at a later stage. So for raster data, I had already downloaded a copy, but I'm going to show you how to download the raster data. And for this vector data, you can let me know if you want to know a lot or in detail about the vector data and how to manipulate it, customize it using QGIS. So for raster data, you can use a website called Natural Earth. So we have the Natural Earth, which is naturalearth.com. So you can navigate to the downloads page. So this is how it looks like. So I've downloaded large scale data for the global data for raster for the 1 into 10 meter resolution, or the scale of 1 into 10 meters. So we have a number of data sets under this. We have the cross blended hypsometric tints, natural earth, 1-2 ocean bottom shaded relief, gray earth, and manual shaded. So I've downloaded natural earth one, so it's already, you can choose this site to download it. I'm also going to share the link in the description below. So let me create a new QGIS project. I'm going to discard this, and since I already have my data, I can use the data source manager. Go to the raster and select my download, which exists here. So it is a GeoTIFF. TIFF is one of the raster formats among many others that are used or can be used in by QGIS. But the GeoTIFF or the TIFF is usually one of the common formats. So I've added that layer. So this is a map of the world, and it's a raster. And as you can see, there's an indication here for that it's a raster file. This icon represents a raster, the one that is next to the one that is next to the checkbox inside the layers panel. So this is a map of the world having a shaded kind of relief. And as you can see, we have shading of which seems to be well pronounced in areas that have the highlands or mountainous areas, and maybe also areas with valleys. As you can see, we have shaded relief near Alaska. We also have some shadings all around Greenland. And then in the Himalayas, we also have the same. Even if you zoom into Ethiopia, you can see something here, the well-known Rift Valley. And if you navigate to the southern South Africa, you see that we have some highlands here. So this is a map of the world, and it's we can look at the properties. So for the properties of a raster, we have under information, you can see it's telling us that this is a GeoTIFF file. and it has three bands, band 1, band 2 and band 3. And we also have other information about it. So you can also check the source. We also have this is a coordinate reference system. We are using the global coordinate reference system indicated by EPSG 4326, or what is known as WGS 84. So we also have this band rendering that we are going to look at it shortly. You can also add your change the transparency of the layer, and then we also have the histogram. You can do a computation of the histogram for each band, and we also have rendering options, pyramids. So these pyramids are used to increase or to load the layer faster when you are using you are zooming in and out. So because you can see these are zoom resolutions for the image. So when you decide to zoom in, if you do not have good pyramids, it might take some time to load, but this one can be well noticed with big data sets or big geotiffs or high resolution satellite imagery, for example. So we have all these items, the metadata. So we are going to look at the styling. So to access the styling, you can either use the properties and you go to the symbology. However, we are not going to use this. We are going to use a quick navigation or a quick tool here. As you can see, we have something at the top here that is looks like a brush. So this one, it also tells us you can open the layer styling panel or F7. You can also press F7 if you're using the normal keyboard for the most Windows machines and Linux. So you can click here and it displays the layer panel or the layer styling panel. And the only thing I'm going to do, first of all, I'm going to zoom to the layer. Just going to change this to the single band gray. And you see what has happened to the layer. It has changed to a kind of a grayscale image. And then you can also change it to the single band pseudo color. And you see that the styling also has also changed. And one thing you'll notice is that in those areas that are desert kind of areas, they have some dark kind of and also the ice regions like the Antarctica, it has the and Greenland, it has the dark blue shade. So you can also try and deduce some information from that. And then we have the hill shade, which kind of changes, it looks a bit rough or embossed some texture. So that's what we have on this raster. So for the raster, you can also, it also has its own calculator whereby you can choose to look at different, let's say we had another layer of the world relief, like this one, the relief features or the hillshade, and we have a layer for a different years. You can use the calculator to compute and create a layer based on different aspects, like or even something like the world population. So this is how you can some of the things you can do with the raster, but for now we're just visualizing it and playing around with the style. So that's it, and thank you for your time.